or with the area, and she currently serves as a vice president of economic initiatives at the Institute for Faith, Work, and Economics, where she focuses on developing a theology of economic freedom. She teaches or has taught at a number of universities, including Georgetown, the Institute for World Politics, George Mason, and Charles University, and the Czech Republic. She's also a visiting scholar at the Bernard Center for Women, Politics, and Public Policy. And she's served as the Associate Director for the Program in Economics, Politics, and Law at the James Buchanan Center at George Mason. Dr. Bradley is also an editor of and contributing author to multiple Institute for Faith, Work, and Economics publications. And in her contributions to these books, she's focused on examining income inequality from both an economic and biblical perspective and provides guidance, particularly to Christians, on how to respond to various arguments they often hear. Dr. Bradley has also done work on the political economy of terrorism, with a particular focus on the organization of Al-Qaeda. Her research has also been featured in various scholarly journals and edited volumes, and she's currently working on a book that analyzes the political economy of Al-Qaeda following 9/11. Based on her academic research, Dr. Bradley has also worked as an economic analyst for the CIA's Office of Terrorism Analysis. We appreciate the work that you do, Dr. Bradley, and thank you for joining us this Saturday morning at our Great Beginning Seminar. All of you, please help me welcome Dr. Bradley.
Thank you, Rod. Thanks so much. Thank you. Sorry. Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here. And I realize it's a tall order to be exposed to income inequality and economics at 9 a.m., but we're going to have fun. As was mentioned, I have been thinking a lot about this issue of income inequality for the past 5 years or so. my organization just came out with an edited volume called Counting the Cost, and it's kind of addressing the question of whether capitalism should be saved or not. And in that, I try to take some of these ideas and kind of flush them out. I will say this. I'm going to get to this in the presentation. So this is baptism by fire. I hope you're ready. 45 minutes of income inequality. And hopefully when you leave, you'll be equipped to kind of think about how to counter some of the narratives that you hear. I will say one thing. I think as people, you know, on the right, people who are conservative, people maybe who are libertarian, I think it's a mistake to deny income inequality exists. I think that's wrong, and I think it's false empirically. So I think where we make a lot of headway is by looking out the window and trying to understand the world as it is. And that's what economists do. So I think that gives you a lot of power when you embrace the economic way of thinking. It allows you to rise above the fray, if you will, and rise above the noise, because a lot of it is just political fighting. That may be fun with your friends, right, on a Friday night. You just have that political fist fight, so to speak. But I don't think it's how we win hearts and minds. And so to win hearts and minds, we have to say, what's going on in the world as we look out the window? Really be honest about what actually are the issues, and then provide a narrative and a way of thinking about how to get to a better world. Because that's really what we're all after, right? We all want a better world. I think you have to extend that assumption to your friends on the left. I think you all have to extend it to even politicians on the left that you might not think you agree with or even like. I think the running assumption for most people is they want to help others. They want to stop poverty. They want to stop exploitation. So if we can all start with we agree on that, then it's just a question of what is the most appropriate mechanism to do that. So that's what I want to try to do today. But first, I have a quiz for you, and you will be graded on this quiz. I'm just kidding. You won't be graded. So this is a quote. You don't necessarily need a choice of 23 underarm spray deodorants or of 18 different pairs of sneakers when children are hungry in this country. Who said this?
Bernie Sanders.
Wow, you guys are too smart for me. Bernie Sanders said this. Okay, so Bernie Sanders has a very specific narrative on income inequality and the relationship between the super rich and the poor in the United States in particular. He has a very specific point of view that this is a problem. The fact that Bill Gates has as many houses as he wants and all the amenities in those homes, and that there are women, single mothers living in Detroit or Baltimore or anywhere else, that gap in and of itself is a problem. Okay, we can talk about that, and we will. And what he says in here, you're understanding his assumptions about economics and about the economic way of thinking. So we have to, I'm just pulling one quote from him, by the way. So he said this, I didn't make it up. So that's the other thing about politicians and anybody else who speaks. We can take them at what they say, assume it's meaningful and thoughtful, and then analyze it. So what is his point of view here? His point of view is that because you can walk into your local grocery store, here we have Giant and Safeway and Harris Teeter and Wegmans, which is the best one in the world if you have been there. And the fact that there are 23 underarm deodorants, the fact that there's not just one, but that there's 23 is excessive and gratuitous and wasteful and means that all these wealthy consumers are, you know, worrying about the wrong things. We're trying to pick on these little margins of what underarm spray we want. And the fact that there's 23 means that there's less for someone else. The fact that, you know, there's 18 different pairs of sneakers, which, by the way, there's many more than that, right? Or you go click on Macy's or Amazon or Nordstrom or wherever you buy these things, and there's not just 18, there's probably hundreds. The fact that there's not just one kind of shoe, don't we need just one kind of shoe, is wasteful. And it means that resources are wasted in the lots of tennis shoes, while, again, we see people that send their kids to school with no shoes. And that is a reality. It is a reality that people are poor. It is a reality that some Americans struggle to make ends meet. So again, we're not going to deny those realities. We're going to embrace those realities. Say what we really want to have a conversation about is, how does income relate to poverty, which is what I'm getting at. Are they related, and what do we do about it? That's what we want to talk about. Okay, so we understand just from one little quote how he thinks about the world. The fact that Bill Gates has 5 houses means there's fewer houses for the poor. The fact that, and I'm ashamed to it, I have little kids, and they walk into my closet, and my son will say, how many purses do you have, Mommy? And they're, you know, up on the thing, and I switch them out. How many purses can you possibly need? It's an embarrassing question. It's a very honest question for my 7-year-old boy, who doesn't understand the need for purses in the first place, right? I'm like, well, you know, I got this one on vacation, so it's sentimental, and this one's pink, so it doesn't go with everything. You know, I mean, women have this all figured out. But in his little mind, it's like, why do you have 7 purses on the shelf that you don't use? So is the fact that am I currently exploiting my fellow human beings who don't have any purses? That's the question, because I don't want to do that. I don't know about you. I don't want to do that. So that's his assumption. So we got to test those assumptions and see if they're right. And economics and the economic way of thinking is the way we do it. Okay, here's another famous quote. Inequality is the root of social evil. That's a whammy. Who said that? Anybody know? It's the most, well, at the time, it was the most retweeted tweet ever. Nope. Good guess, though. Not Hillary. Pope Francis. So Pope Francis came to visit the United States, what, 1.5 years ago? And that this is what he said. He also has very explicit points of view on inequality, income inequality, wealth inequality. He says it's the root of social evil. Okay, so here's the thing. Why do I put these two people up here? I'm picking two out of a sea of people we could talk about, right? You may not, I'm going to assume a few things about you, agree with Bernie Sanders politically. Is that an okay assumption for this room? You may not agree with him. You may think he's uninformed, stupid, a socialist, a jerk, whatever, okay? Here's a guy who you may very much agree with. So the point in all of this is to say, I think we need to extend to others the assumption that they care about people. It's very easy for me to think that Pope Francis and to believe that he cares about the poor. That's not a very controversial statement, right? But you might say, I don't really think Bernie Sanders cares about the poor. Well, maybe we should extend that to him and just assume it's true. These guys together, again, I just picked two people. We could have picked a lot of people, okay? So I'm just picking on two people because of what they've said. They're assuming certain things about inequality. So this is a statement that inequality, he doesn't say income inequality. If you look at his writings, that's what he talks about the most. So I'm gonna assume that's what he means here, okay? That income inequality, its very existence, is damaging. That's a profound statement, so we need to assess it. So we're not assuming any bad motives about these guys. I don't think we need to do that. I also don't think it helps you win hearts and minds to just run around and say, I'm not saying you do this, but a lot of people do it if you listen to the news. This person is a jerk. This person's a socialist. And maybe they are a socialist, but you know, don't assume that they're socialists because they're jerks. Assume they're socialists because it's their understanding of the world. And then we can combat that with truth. I think that gives us a lot of power in the debate, okay? So that's what we want to do. So this has to start with some economic realities. How many people are econ majors here or have taken any economics? Okay, a few. So this is a crash course, ready for 3 minutes of econ. But it gives you all that you need to know, or a lot of what you need to know. And if people want further reading and links on this, I'm happy to provide it later, as well as my PowerPoint, if you want that. The first one is so obvious, yet we take it for granted. And that is, we live in a world of scarce resources that have multiple and competing ends. So scarcity is the backbone of economics. If there is no scarcity, economists go away. We don't need it, right? You don't have to make trade-offs in a world without scarcity. You don't have to choose. You can have everything you want at the moment you want it and somehow consume it and enjoy it simultaneously. There's no trade-offs. The fact of scarcity, that we can't have everything we want at the moment we want it, implicitly means that we're always paying a cost. You being here right now means you're not doing something else. You gave up something to be here. I gave up something to be here. You choosing a college means you forego other opportunities, work, volunteer, etc., right? There's always a cost, even if there's no price. So even if if I say, hey guys, let's go out after this and I'll take everybody to lunch and I'll pay, still not free for you because you have to attend the lunch. So you're actually giving up your most precious asset, which is your time. That's your time, okay? So we live in a world of scarce resources that have multiple and competing ends. So there's trade-offs. So we want to use those scarce resources and put them to their highest valued uses. That's what economics is about. Prices are the very thing that help us do that. So F.A. Hayek wins the Nobel Prize in the 80s for writing on this. 70s, actually. Sorry. So he wins the Nobel Prize for a shortish article called The Use of Knowledge in Society. I highly recommend it if you're really interested, if you're an econ nerd like me. So he talks about prices helping us ration resources that are scarce because they provide us with information and signals and they coordinate us, okay? So we want them to be able to work. What we know and what he goes further into in much of his later works is that markets run by profits, losses, supply, and demand are the very thing that helps us do this the best, okay? So market economies work because they allow decentralized individuals to come together via prices. And you need a stable system of property rights for that to work. All right. Incentives matter for human decision making. Incentives matter. What does that mean? It means that we can't live in a world where we rely on the altruism or benevolence of others to get what we want and need. This is kind of a counter to what you hear Bernie saying. He wants a world where, we kind of engage in a sharing economy, perhaps. There's nothing wrong with sharing, by the way. I bet you do it a lot. You probably share with your friends. Where's the unit where the sharing most often occurs for everyone? Families, right? I am definitely a central planner in my house. But that works because I love my children, but I tell them what to do. I tell them what, we're having for dinner tonight. I'm in charge. I'm the dictator. However, it works because I love them and I care about them in many ways, right? So this works there, but I have to have the incentive. So if you take the family and you try to take the model of that and you try to push it onto a society of 330 million people, why does it not work? Because we can't love everybody like we love our family. Not only that, but you can't know what people need and you don't have a mechanism to get them what they need. Prices do that for us. And the incentives of profit and the disincentives of losses are exactly what encourage the people who run Walmart, the people who run Amazon to care about you. That's pretty amazing because it actually markets generate empathy, right? The people at Walmart, I don't know them. I go there all the time. But they actually care that I pay the lowest possible amount for my shampoo. Why would they care? They don't know me, right? They're rich billionaires. Well, they have the incentives that if a lot of us go there because cereal and shampoo and all the stuff is cheaper, then they're going to make money. So incentives matter for human decision making. We can't kind of exist in a world where we're just hoping to find the best person to run an economy or to run a society. And by the way, the most impoverished societies in the world are the places where you have dictators in sole control. And how many dictators, how many people that are put in a position of having absolute control over an economy, political and legal institutions, act benevolently? We don't see this. And human history shows a very sad record of what happens under that type of power structure, right? So we have to have a way to get out of that. And then when we focus on our gifts, our talents, economists talk about this idea as comparative advantage. We're relatively good at a few things compared to other people, okay? So market economies encourage each of you to become specialists in your gifts and your talents. And then they provide incentives for you to sell your labor to the highest bidders, right? That's why you're going to college, right? You're becoming specialists. And then you're going to go out there, and what are you going to seek? The highest income you can, right? It's not because you're a greedy jerk, by the way. It's because you've put a lot of investment and you want to get the highest return. That's the same thing that drives, you know, Jeff Bezos and Mark Cuban and Bill Gates. But we want that kind of natural inclination for self-interest to be motivated into a way that serves other people. Okay, so wasn't that fun? That was Economics 101 in one slide in like 6 minutes. But this is the important framework, because remember what I said is I started by analyzing that something Bernie Sanders said. I didn't put words in his mouth. I took it for what it was, and I said, okay, is this true? Is it true that Walmart has a lot of, you know, cereals? My favorite aisle, by the way, and I don't even eat cereal, but my favorite aisle in the grocery store is cereal, or I don't eat cereal often, because it's ceiling to floor. Boxes of stuff. It's amazing, right? It's amazing, and it's like at the most $7 or something, which I would never pay $7 for cereal, but the fancy granola is like $7 for, you know, not, it's a little tiny box, right? But the variety makes me wealthy, not impoverished. So my narrative about the cereal aisle is very different than Bernie Sanders' narrative about the cereal aisle. Why? Because of an understanding of the role that profit, losses, and property rights play in all of this. That I'm actually better off when there's a lot of variety because I get to choose exactly what I want. Maybe not exactly, right? But I have a lot of variety in my choice. Whereas a world where some dictator or some economic czar has to choose what the one box of cereal is going to be, because we can only have one, because if we have 1,000, it's wasteful. You see, that doesn't work. It hasn't worked, and the record of human history is very clear on this. So let's jump from the kind of economic way of thinking in that framework to what does income inequality mean and what does it tell us? So I'm going to go through some of this quickly, but I can provide a lot of different reading materials if you're interested in learning some of it later. I think if you read Shakespeare or the Bible, income inequality is not a new idea. Okay, we've been talking about the rich against the poor forever. I think it had a resurgence with the Occupy Wall Street movement, right? The 99% versus the 1%. I think this got extended into the 2016 presidential election, certainly with the narratives about the rich and the poor and what are we going to do about it. So I think it's gotten a lot of political traction recently, and I'm not sure that's going to go away with the next presidential election or even, you know, the congressional and senatorial elections in between. But this issue, what I'm saying here is we need to have a narrative. We need to be able to have a conversation with our friends on the left about what's the deal here? So income inequality is a real kind of emotional push point for people. And I think they go to the polls based on their feelings on this. So it's important, right? So we want clarity on it. All right, so I'm going to give you, again, a minute overview on how economists measure income inequality. And we do it through something called the Gini score. Has anybody heard of this? Okay, my econ guys, right? The Gini coefficient, the Gini index, the Gini score, they're all the same thing. All right, a Gini score is a statistical measurement of how income is held over a certain group. We could do a Gini score for you guys in this room. We could get a Gini score, okay? We could do it over all Fairfax County. We could do it over all of Virginia. We could do it over all of the US. So it's all gonna depend upon the size of the population that we're measuring, all right? It ranges from a 0 to 1. That's all I'm gonna tell you right now. I'll tell you one more thing. 0 to 1. 0, perfect income equality, meaning everybody has the exact same income. You with me? 1, perfect income inequality. One person has all the income, everybody else has 0. Are you with me? Okay. Country A has a Gini score of 0.278. Country B has a Gini score of 0.457. Based on 30 seconds of discussion about income inequality, where do you think you want to live? Who wants to live in A? Closer to equality. Okay. Who wants to live in B? Who doesn't have enough information? Okay. All right. So I think there could be cases made for any answer. I could understand somebody saying, well, just based on what you told me, which was a minute of information, this sounds better. It sounds like there's a more even distribution, and maybe that sounds good. Country B, is it bad? I don't know. I mean, what does 0.457 even mean? Hard to say, right? Maybe you think it sounds more like in the middle, so that sounds better. Who knows? I mean, it's hard to know, again, without a lot of information, right? And some people said, I just don't have enough, which I think is intellectually honest of you. These are real Gini scores. I did not make them up. So this is the Gini score of Afghanistan today, 0.278. And this is the Gini score of the United States today, 0.457. So what does that tell you? Well, gosh, I'm not gonna pack up my bags and say, let's move to Afghanistan tomorrow because they have a better Gini score than the United States, right? In fact, Afghanistan is literally one of the poorest places on the planet. A place ruled by thugs. A place where you're born into exploitation and poverty, and it's very hard to leave. So we should desire to change that for our fellow human beings who are born into such a situation, right? But you can see that if I'm just looking at the 0 to 1, this seems better on paper. This maybe seems less equal. But in reality, maybe this is, you know, not desirable compared to this. Now, I could have put a lot of different comparisons on here. And if you look at, you can go online and find a ranking of all the Gini scores. And it's a very complicated thing. So that's what I want to help us understand here, too, is these are complex, nuanced conversations that we need to have. And I'm going to go a little bit deeper into why this is a very difficult thing to measure. So the Gini score is really, as economists, all we have as an empirical metric of the statistical differences in income, but it's really not very powerful. So I personally, if I was president, I wouldn't hang my hat on it because it doesn't give us a lot of the information that we actually desire to know, which is how are people doing? What is it like to be poor? How do people get out of poverty? Isn't that the question? And is the fact that there's income inequality, that there are some people who have more income than others, by definition, exploitative? That's a lot of questions I just threw out at us, and we have, you know, not a lot of time to answer them, but that's what I want to prompt you to think about. So, you know, what does the Gini tell us? What does it tell us? I think it doesn't tell us some of the most important parts of the question that we want to know. Well, how are people doing? I just asked that, right? How are people doing? What is it like to be the single mother living in, you know, kind of a gang-filled neighborhood in Baltimore? This is a reality right down the street from us, by the way. We're not that far from that right now. What is life like for her and her kids? And what does it take? This is the question. This is the $64 million question. What does it take for her to not be in that situation anymore? How does she break out of those chains of poverty? And is it the fact that there are rich people in Baltimore that have, you know, very nice houses and safe neighborhoods, are the fact that they have a lot, does that necessarily put her in that position? Because that's the narrative that we hear about income inequality. The fact that there are people who are wealthy takes away from the people at the bottom. It's a zero-sum game idea. That's what we want to explore. In some parts of the world, Afghanistan, zero-sum game. How do you become wealthy? You get politically connected, you get guns, right? You run drugs, you exploit. That is a zero-sum game. So in Afghanistan, those people who are quote-unquote rich are usually the people who are in charge, who have political and exploitive power. That is a zero-sum game. They can only maintain that position by exploiting those and living off the backs of other people. That is not the same as Bill Gates' wealth. He can't put a gun to your head, presumably, and make you buy his products. In fact, I bet a lot of people here have different products, right? Apple products and other types of products, right? So it's the nature of diversity of consumer products provides discipline on the producers of those things, such that they have to consider our needs and our desires. So that's the kind of world we want to live in. What are the consumption capabilities of the poor? So what is it like to be poor? What can they consume? What is their purchasing power? We'll talk about that in a minute. And again, my question, what does it take to no longer be poor? The Gini coefficient doesn't tell us this stuff. It simply tells us at a point in time when we measure income differences, how much you have versus how much you have. But that's all it tells us. It doesn't tell us how you got the money. It doesn't tell us what your purchasing power is, what kind of goods and services can you consume. And it doesn't tell us anything about the prospect of you gaining more income in the future, which is actually what we care about. If we claim to care about the poor, we need to care about how do they grow their income, right? So I think it doesn't tell us a lot of what we need. Again, economists have to use what they have. But what I see missing in the conversation is thoughtfulness. You know, we could just say, oh, be more like Afghanistan, have a better Gini score. Nobody would say that, I hope. It's insane to say that, right? And so we need to be thoughtful and nuanced in our thinking. Now, this is income inequality over time in the US. Since we've been able to formally measure it, we can go back further, but in 1913, right, we started federal income taxes. This is how we measure the Gini, how we get the scores, by collecting income tax returns. So that's how we understand people's income. So this takes us from 1913 to 2007 probably is when this ends. And what do you see? This is the whole Gini from 0 to 1. We hover between 0.4 and 0.5. This is the Great Depression, right? We shoot right above, it's like 0.501 or something, right at this point in time. And you would expect a lot of income inequality or a little upshoot when, you know, think about the Great Depression, the currency is totally destroyed. So only the people at the very top have a little bit of security around this, but most people lose everything. Goes back down, it kind of is very flat, but what you do see is an uptick since the 70s. And this is what the Bernie Sanders, maybe your friends on the left, this is what they talk about. And I don't think if you look at this graph, you can deny that it's going up. You can't. So it's not helpful to say, income inequality is not a problem, don't worry about it. That's not how we win hearts and minds, by just being dismissive, right? We say, sure, it's going up. And when I look at this as somebody who's trying to study this, I say, well, what's making it go up? And how much is it going to go up? Right now, it's not like it went from, 0.45 to 9. Anybody should probably be worried about that, I suppose. But, what is a good Gini score? Is 0.6 good? What are we after? What is our end goal? And, if you ask people that, even if you ask economists to study this, that it's hard to say objectively what the good score is. What are we after? Are we after get down to 0.2? That would be better. It's hard to know. Again, the deeper questions are, how do people get their income? How do they keep their income? What causes them to lose their income? Those are the real questions, and those are more institutional questions about the markets. So when you see this here, we can't deny that we have to accept that it exists, but then question, what's the motivating factor here? Why is it like this? So I talked about this a little bit, but what I want to talk about here, and then we'll kind of move on to income mobility a little bit, is what influences the Gini score to be what it is. Here's the other thing I'll say to you up front, and this is my first point, is, what are the demographics of households? What do they look like? It is a very bad thing, in my opinion, and usually when economists measure income inequality, they do country-to-country comparisons. So we'll say something like the U.S. is 0.457. I don't know off the top of my head what Sweden is, but it's, or Denmark, right? We're supposed to be more like Denmark, and I think in some ways we could be more like Denmark, and that would be good. But Denmark might have a Gini score, I think it's around 0.38 or 0.35, or it's lower than the U.S. So what's the problem with that? Well, if you're just thinking about the math, measuring a Gini score amongst 330 million people, not all of whom earn incomes, some are elderly, some are babies, right, and some are not working, is very different than having a Gini score compared to a country of 8 million people. So Denmark is the size of Manhattan, has the population of Manhattan. And the Gini index is by definition a statistical dispersion measurement tool. So it's you can see the problems right away, right? Unless you're adjusting for the population size, you're automatically gonna get a different number. So that's one factor of influence, is that it's hard to compare Gini scores across countries because you're not comparing apples to apples. You're comparing apples to oranges. You're comparing 330 million people to, if we did India, 1.3 billion people, to Denmark, 7 million people, right? That's a big difference. There's a lot more diversity in the population, too, of the United States. One thing that we know that changed, you know, I showed you that graph and it kind of was flat for a long time, then it went up in the 70s. Well, what happened in the 60s and 70s to women in the United States? They joined the workforce in droves. Why? Because they hadn't been allowed to before for a lot of different reasons. Cultural, you know, prejudicial, legal. So women entering the workforce, where are they entering? Are they entering at the top of the income distribution or at the bottom or closer to the bottom? Well, they're probably all over the place. But you're talking about a class of people who haven't worked in those quantities before. Right? So relative to their male counterparts in 1970, they have lower levels of education and lower levels of experience. So what does that mean? They're entering the income distribution at a lower amount. That's going to pull your Gini, or that's going to make your Gini go up. But actually, it's a good thing to have women be able to enter the workforce, right? Same thing if minorities are excluded, right? And have been excluded from the workforce, and then they're allowed to enter the workforce. What is that gonna do? It's actually a good thing and a sign of a vibrant economy when we have more people who were excluded able to enter. But if they're entering at the bottom of the income distribution, they're gonna skew the Gini. So you can actually have something that's good, but that empirically shows up in the Gini as bad. Does that make sense? So again, we have to peel the onion here to really understand what we're talking about. People on the left also talk about the Reagan tax cuts of the early 80s. So what happened here, there's a lot of sophisticated tax stuff I won't get into, but basically if you look at this, what happened with those tax cuts was this. It changed the viability of holding corporate income. So it used to be pre-1982 that it was more attractive to hold corporate income as stocks and bonds and things like this, right, as corporate assets. So the tax code changes with what Reagan signed in the early 80s, and then what happens? People change their corporate holdings into personal holdings. So overnight, you get some CEO, right? Let's say he has $5 million in corporate stocks, and he puts them in his Bank of America account. I'm being simplistic here, but it goes from a corporate stock, and it's held, it's not counted in your income tax return in the same way, right? And then now it's in your Bank of America account. So a lot of the people who examine income inequality, who come to it in the Bernie Sanders fashion, will say, well, what happened in the 80s is that Reagan initiated tax cuts that helped the rich, they hurt the poor, and look what happened. The Gini starts going up right when this happens. So the question is really, it's an accounting difference, right? Somebody had their income here, and they moved it over here. So income inequality didn't change in that point of time. The way people held their assets changed. But again, this manufactures itself into the Gini in a negative way. The question is it bad to cut corporate taxes? You know, the answer is no. It gives more, you know, businesses more money to invest in building and growing, you know, their businesses. And that tends to increase employment, lower prices, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a lot that goes into this. Immigration. Now, we could save that whole conversation for another day. Economists, you know, a lot of the data on immigration is that if it's done properly, immigration is really good for a vibrant economy. But whether you buy that or not, without another talk, maybe, you know, we'd have to talk about it. But the point is that when you have immigrants entering a workforce at all, where are they entering? It's going to affect your Gini, right? If you have a lot of PhDs entering your workforce, they're going to enter at high income levels.
If you have people that are escaping bad situations and they have no education or little education and low levels of skills, they're entering your workforce at low levels, right? And so an influx of immigrants from a certain place or an influx of refugees can alter your Gini for good or for bad. But it doesn't really get us to the bottom line of the question, which is that productive for a society, right? So all these things affect our Gini score. And then also, I think the most important thing here is tax returns. Here's the biggest problem that we have as economists when we measure the Gini score. The biggest problem is this. Let's say we calculated Gini score based on incomes in 2000. All right, how many of you were working in the year 2000? Zero. Okay, so you're not entering the Gini very favorably. You're not helping us out because you're babies, right? Now, let's say we do Gini score again in 2020. How many of you are going to be working in 2020? Hopefully all of you, right, in some capacity. So here's the problem. The Gini score is a snapshot in time. We take it in 2000, we take it in 2010, we take it in 2020. But what's the problem? How old were you guys in 2000? Please say you were born. I hope I'm not old. Okay, I'm old, but not that old. Okay, good. So you were barely born, right? You were barely born in 2000. We're not gonna hold it against you that you're not being productive income earners yet, because you're 3 or 2 or 1 or not born, right? So the problem with this is to really understand whether people's incomes are growing, you'd have to take the same group of people and get their tax returns every year for 20 years. And that actually helps us measure income mobility, not income inequality. Again, income inequality, what's the problem? The people we were measuring in 2000 aren't the same people that we're measuring in 2020. We expect people who enter the workforce to enter at low levels. We expect them to exit the workforce at much higher levels than they enter, right? That's probably what all of you are gonna do. You're gonna start off at a job, and you're gonna be really excited with your first job, right? You're gonna wish you made more. And then you're gonna get more experience and you're gonna get a lot better and you're gonna get raises. And when you leave the workforce, we expect your income to be a lot bigger than when you entered. That's natural, right? Because you're gaining experience, you're gaining skills. So this is the problem, is it's a very hard thing to measure because we're not tracking individuals over time. And that's really my biggest, if I had to sum this up as what are the problems with the Gini? It doesn't tell us about population size, taxes and transfers, what are the tax rates? By the way, if we tax people and we do that, that's a deduction from their income, right? And then we take some of those taxes and it's called a transfer payment. We give it to people at the bottom of the income. So the people at the bottom are receiving an income injection via taxes. In many cases, when people calculate the Gini, they don't count for taxes and transfers, which means they're overestimating income inequality. We have to account for this. And it depends on who's doing the Gini, right? Different countries measure this different ways. So you have to know what you're looking at. And then again, I said the demographic changes. Women entering the workforce who've been excluded, minorities entering the workforce who've been excluded, immigrants, all these type of things are gonna change your Gini. And then the biggest question, are we tracking individual people? And usually we're not. However, when we can, here's what we find out. This is a great study. These are hard to come by, because you need to track people over about 20 years to really get good data, or 10 years. So it takes a long time to come up with it. The US Treasury did this study in 2007. This, I think, remember, what's the question Bernie Sanders is raising? It's a good question. We should not be dismissive of his question, which is, how do we care for the poor? That should be our leading question, by the way. It really should. Not just defense of the rich or whatever. We get, we on the right really get blamed for this a lot. And I think some of that is just. We shouldn't just be defending the Bill Gateses of the world. We should be leading with, I want to help the poor. Is income inequality really a problem? If it is, how do I fix it? What's going on? So income mobility, I think, gets us a lot closer to addressing that real question. So I don't know how well you can see this, but this is what the Treasury did. They took a group of individuals and they took their tax returns from 1996 to 2005. So 9 years following the same group of individuals, getting their tax returns each year and then measuring where they went in terms of their income. And look at this. If you were in the lowest income quintile in 1996, there is a 90.5% chance you're at least in the next highest income quintile by 2005. That's good news. I want it to be faster. I want it to be 100%, right? That's what we want. But it shows that in the United States, there is income mobility. You don't have to stay at the bottom. Again, and that helps us get to, well, what are the programs that help the poor? Things like this, right? In the second income, it gets lower as it goes up, which is what you'd expect. But here's what's really interesting and totally undiscussed, in my opinion. In the top 1%, which is who gets all the blame for ruining society, right? There's a negative income mobility. A negative income mobility. This is important in a dynamic market economy. In Afghanistan, there's no negative income mobility for the thugs, right? They don't get delegitimized. They just keep being thugs. Why? Because they've got all the guns. That's how society works, right? When you're a thug. So the difference here is in the top 1%, there's a 25% chance that you're going to be knocked back an income quintile in just 9 years. That is, in economics, what we call profits and losses. We want the people that are entrepreneurs, whether they're super rich entrepreneurs or your cousin who runs a food truck. What do we want from them? We want them to be cutting edge, to innovate, to figure out how to give us better products at lower prices. And consumers are the ones that levy the profits and levy the losses in a market-based society. So when Bill Gates loses a lot, I keep picking on him, he's just an easy target. When he loses a lot of money, why? It's because we say, somebody else did a better job. I'm gonna buy a MacBook Air or whatever, right? I want something different. That's important because it means that just because you have economic wealth doesn't mean you have political power. And that starts to help us understand that income inequality in and of itself might not be a bad thing. I want to live in a world, I don't know about you, where there's really smart people thinking about how to cure cancer. And when they do, I want them to be really, really wealthy because it's a big problem. And it's going to take a really smart person or group of people to solve it. And we want to reward them with that because we're all going to live longer, better lives from it, right? And so this is the society, I think, that we all want to live in. Even Bernie Sanders wants to live in this society, right? He's older than us, so he's probably going to desire healthcare benefits that are cutting edge sooner than you are. Now, let's look at the world and talk about it for a second. Then I want to try to stop for questions soon. This is amazing. I have to kind of find a way to get this graph in front of everybody I speak in front of. Not just because I'm an economist and we feel like the need to use graphs, but this is astounding what you see here. This is GDP, gross domestic product, right, which is a measure of wealth per capita, so per person, over all of human history in one little handy-dandy graph. Okay, so this is broken out by countries, so don't worry about that. Worry about the main trend that you see here. So what do we see? AD1, long time ago, to now. Now, a lot of economists have really done a good job measuring this, so independently, and they've come to the same conclusions. But they're back of the envelope calculations. In 81, we didn't have a Census Bureau, right? So, you know, we're trying to estimate what we think per capita GDP was. By most estimates, most human beings, for most of human history, have lived between zero and $200 per capita a year. At the very highest estimations, it's $400 a year. That goes on until about 1600, and you get a little lift off of zero. And you stay there for a while, and then you get what we refer to as the Industrial Revolution, which means a lot of different things are changing. It's not just we came up with the steamboat or whatever. It's institutions were changing, our attitudes about the, you know, autonomy of the individual and human dignity are changing. So there's a lot going on culturally with ideas as well as with economics. And then it just goes gangbusters. And what you see, this is called the hockey stick graph because that's exactly what it looks like, right? You and I are born, we're living in the handle of the hockey stick. I mean, hallelujah to that because we, you know, have a lot of things that we benefit from that our ancestors couldn't even dream about having. Right, we're sitting in an air-conditioned room with microphones and you have smartphones and you're college students, right? I mean, all these things. And we had nothing to do with them. Those things reduce income inequality because they provide, living in the handle of the hockey stick means that you have a chance You have a better chance because of all the things at your disposal to become wealthy. See, here's the thing, and I want you to think about your male or female counterpart in the developing world. Right now, there are women that wake up, that's my counterpart, right, in the developing world today, and they're going to go walk 4 miles to get water. They're going to use a discarded container. They're going to have to, they bring their daughters with them. They face a lot of danger on the road. They have to come back. They crudely purify the water. They drink it, and you got to do it again. And you got to do it again. And you got to do it again. This takes all your time. In fact, what we know about that is that it takes more calories than income to survive. And we're talking about people who live on less than $2 a day. It takes more calories than income to accomplish this task. So it requires 3,000 calories maybe to do all. Can you imagine? We go to the gym, why? For fun, right? My friend went on a trip to Africa. He's an economist. He was doing some anthropological research, and he's it's like a super marathon runner. He's crazy. But you run 50 miles intentionally. I don't understand it. But he's running while he's there because he's still training. And he said people were staring at him. You have to be very rich, very wealthy. And he's a college professor. He's not Bill Gates. But in real terms, he's so wealthy that he can dedicate his extra time to burning up so many calories that he like just gets to sit at the buffet and eat whatever he wants. When you think about that, what we really are after is changing the conditions of the poor in the world so that they are free to innovate. So the thing about the water collection is it takes all your time. And you don't have time to go to college. You don't have time to think about new products. But the fact that you guys didn't have to make your clothes this morning, and you didn't have to grow your breakfast, and you have this handy-dandy little computer that tells you stuff, that helps you track your day, right? You can be ordering from Amazon right now and have junk delivered to your hotel room. Like, it's amazing. It frees up your time. So I think the narrative and the conversation around income inequality is incorrect in this way. One, it doesn't help us understand what people can actually consume. And because we live in the handle of the hockey stick, people can consume a lot more for a lot less than they used to. So that's one point. I also think that the Gini coefficient conversation alone doesn't tell us about mobility. This graph shows us that the whole world is gaining income mobility. So here's the way I like to sum it up. Income inequality, I like it to call it the good, the bad, and the ugly. There's income inequality that's good, and it's the type of behavior that we see in people like Bill Gates and Steve Jobs, right, when he was with us. It's coming up with an idea and taking a risk on that idea and becoming very wealthy because people are like, hey, that's a great idea. I want to buy your stuff. That income inequality, the fact that they're rich, does not make you poor. It makes you richer. Bill Gates being rich makes you richer because you don't have to figure out how to build an operating system, right? But the income inequality that comes from cronyism, that comes from corporations who cozy up with the state and buy political favors through campaign contributions, this happens in the United States. That is the results in the worst type of income inequality because it's the people who are already rich, right? The large corporations go down to K Street. It's just corporations. And why are they on K Street? Why does GE need an office downtown? Well, they need to legislate or lobby for what is going to protect them. Not all lobbying is bad, by the way. But lobbying for the purpose of political favoritism is not how we got this. That's the point I want to leave you with. So I think these things are really important. I think this conversation is incredibly nuanced. It requires a lot of thoughtfulness. But I think what our starting point should be is not, man, it doesn't exist. That's not helpful. And it's also not true. Cronyism is a real problem in the United States. It's a real problem. There's so many examples I could give you. Cash for clunkers, right? The 2009 electricity bill where GE and Sylvania basically lobbied for old light bulbs to be made illegal. Why? Because they had a patent on new light bulbs that are $20 a pop, by the way. Ask your parents. Because we all ran out and bought these light bulbs, right? They created a monopoly through political favoritism. That results in the worst type of inequality because it actually results in GE, who's already rich, getting richer, and then smaller light bulb corporations, they don't have the same chance to or opportunity to play. And then consumers, why would I pay $20 for a light bulb when I could pay a dollar? Now, if it's worth $20, I would pay that, but I want the choice. Don't make the old one illegal. you're constraining my choices, and that makes me poor, and that feeds into the broader Gini coefficient problem. So I'm going to stop there and happy to take questions for the next few minutes that we have. I could talk all day about this, but I want to make sure I'm fielding questions that you may have. Oh, thanks. I know, income inequality at 9 a.m. is a rough one. Yeah, hi.
Hi, I'm John Browning.
Hi, John.
I just wanted to ask you about a couple of leftist arguments that I encounter daily.
Please. Yes.
They claim that this is this tremendous waste that could be by a more socialist.
Good question. So everybody hear that? So capitalism is inefficient. Why? Because we spend a lot of time on advertising. Look around you. I mean, people spend tons of money and effort on advertising. I find it humorous that I like to do online shopping. My husband doesn't like it when I do that. But, you know, I just click on these different things, and I look around, and I don't really buy as much as I look at, which is good. And then when I go into my Yahoo account, what's on the banner on the side? Did you want to get those bar stools from West Elm? You forgot to buy your pillows from Pottery Barn, like, you know, all this stuff. So I think the claim is right. There's a lot of money spent on advertising. The question is it inefficient? And, you know, so here's what the economic way of thinking always forces us to do. Two questions we always ask. What's the cost and what are the alternatives? That's the economic way of thinking, because we want to know, is capitalism inefficient? Maybe it is. It's not perfectly efficient because it's made up of human beings. And human beings aren't perfectly efficient. Firms fail. Firms, even the ones who have the best integrity, make bad decisions, right? Why? Because we don't know. We don't have a crystal ball. We can't plan the world that way. So I think it's, for your friends, I think it's the right thing to say, you're right. There's probably more money spent on advertising than there could be in some other universe. Fine, give it to them. I don't think we have to hold on to everything, right? I think we have to address the issues, but say, what are the alternatives? Are we going to tell Microsoft and Apple, are we going to pass a law that says, here's how much you can spend? We could do that. It's very easy to do that. But then how are the regulators going to know what the right amount is? And once you set up a regulatory agency, how do you prohibit that regulatory agency from becoming captured by special interest groups? And again, the record of history, just time and time and time again, shows that when we put people in political positions to manage economic affairs, this always happens. The special interests and the people with the power will drive that agenda. So I don't think I think it's okay to admit, like, you know, maybe there's too much money spent on advertising. But even as an economist, I would say to you, I don't know that there's too much. How does anybody know what the right amount is? And advertising is getting cheaper, not more expensive. So it used to be in 1950. I mean, has anybody watched the show Mad Men? I mean, you know, you'd have a whole creative team, and you'd have to buy newspaper space to put an ad in the newspaper. Now, it's like very inexpensive to do this digitally. So actually, the cost of advertising is going down. And if advertisers are moving along their demand curve, then you're going to see more advertising. So I don't even know that it's inefficient. But I think it's OK to say, OK, maybe. But what's the alternative? The alternative is far worse.
And then my one other argument that I hear a lot is that that hockey stick was created because Western countries exploited resources from the colonial world and just used them to produce all that GDP. So
yeah, I think that colonialism has a very ugly history. Again, I don't think we need to say that. And it's really countries when they come out of that colonial rule is when they are allowed to thrive. So I don't think you have to deny that point either. But this is absolutely not because of colonialism, and here's why. It's the undoing of colonialism that is allowing these poor countries who have been poor for much longer to catch up. So the conversation that I like to have, I don't think I have a graph on it, is economic freedom. And economic freedom is measured, there's a couple of organizations that measure this empirically, Fraser Institute, Heritage, there's a bunch of them. But what they do is they try to actually kind of give each country a score in terms of how it's doing and why is it doing poorly, or why is it thriving? And I would say the biggest hindrance to economic flourishing is statism, bad dictatorial authoritarian government. So I think if you look, here's the problem that you guys encounter in a world of tweeting, right? It's easy to say stuff like, well, that's just colonialism. And then you're left to do all the intellectual heavy lifting to say, well, go read these 10 books and then let's have a conversation about how that's not true. That's hard, you know? It's hard to win the Twitter wars when what they're selling on the left, I don't mean to sound conspiratorial, but it's easy to buy. What Bernie Sanders sells to people is easy to buy. There's poor people, there's rich people, the rich people are bad, and the government's good. And the government's gonna come in and level the playing field. I mean, that sounds good on paper. The problem is, history doesn't bear out those results. History bears out Venezuela, the Soviet Union, Zimbabwe. I mean, so I think that's a deeper, more intellectual conversation, but if your friends are willing to have it with you, go for it. But I think you just have to say, well, that's, you know, that's absurd. And here's why. Here's kind of four reasons why, which is that it's actually the more people are turning towards market economies. You know, we're getting more types of democracy. It's on the rise. Economic freedom is on the rise. And what do those things mean? Well, they're empowering ordinary people.
All right. Thank you.
Sure.
Hello. My name's Kevin. I go to the University of Virginia.
Great.
How do we encourage a social fabric that defends property rights and free market economy while also encouraging the best kinds of private charity and giving?
Yeah, generosity. Uh-huh. Yeah, so it's interesting that you ask that because I also think this is a kind of point that the left will bring up, which is that, you know, if we just kind of reduce, you know, taxes and let the rich be rich, then, you know, we're not going to get any charity and we're not going to get generosity. So I'll give your answer or answer you in two ways. One, I think, is more fundamental, which is that there's an ethos that must require, that must undergird a market-based society, right? It's the ethos of private property rights. It's the ethos of prudence and stewardship and waiting. You know, I mean, an entrepreneur, think of the biggest entrepreneurs. They invest millions, billions of dollars, and they don't see a return for a long time. That's restraint. So these kind of virtues must undergird a system of property rights. And property rights are only going to be respected if we all operate on that system, right? I respect yours and you respect mine. I mean, this is the very problem in the worst places in the world, Zimbabwe. Nobody respects each other's property rights, so they just steal from each other. And then, you know, you become elite by being a good thief, essentially. So that's one issue that's, I think, important, is we're not just going to fix broken societies by saying, go do what we do. There has to be a belief, deep belief in some of these ideas for them to work. And I think that's what's made the United States a very prosperous, long-term, wealthy society. But the other thing I would say to you is that if you look at the record, it's societies like the United States that are the most generous. And I think the problem is when we take more from private individuals, whether it's through taxes or redistribution or regulatory regimes that restrict what people can do, there's less left over to be generous with. And so, you know, I have friends and who are doing a lot of work on the role of the church in societies, not, you know, churches, not one specific church. But, you know, when Tocqueville wrote Democracy in America, which I highly encourage everybody to read, what he saw was a vibrant civil society where people took care of each other. And America was a lot less rich then when he wrote that than we are now. Well, why did that happen? He saw people coming together because they had these virtues in place, and where the market couldn't do something, they didn't run to the state. You know, churches created hospitals. So I think the churches and other charities get eclipsed by the state as the state becomes more bloated and massive because there's fewer resources. So if you want benevolence and altruism and generosity, I agree with Bernie Sanders on this. I want everybody to be more generous. But the way to do that is to enable and empower the free market and to reduce the size of the state, not to expand it. So that's kind of a more long-term conversation. But I think there's two things there. It's an ethics system that must occur with a free market economy. And then there's the outcomes of a free market economy, which is that people have more to give.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Hi, I'm Amber. I'm from Pellissippi State Community College in Knoxville, Tennessee. My question is, how do you debate the Nordic countries? Because usually we hear, I guess it's back to basics, I guess, but we hear mostly from the right, we just hear about the car tax. Oh, it's double the price. But then the left comes back with well, free healthcare, free college, free universal health, basic income, et cetera, et cetera. And you also said in some ways you think we could be like Denmark, and which ways would you think?
Yeah, so this is just, again, one of those tweets that's it's like, stop the Twitter wars, because there's no depth or thoughtfulness, by the way, in that. But, you know, it's easy to say, well, we should be more like Denmark. Again, that sounds good on paper, and I think that it's not entirely false. So here's kind of my brief sketch on that. Here's where I would go to the evidence. Economic freedom as a metric of flourishing and the robustness of a free market society. I encourage you all to look it up. But we rank and score countries. Right now, I'm fairly confident, I'd have to look at the numbers. The United States is number 16. UK is 10. Denmark is probably between 10 and 16. Probably, but it's in the top 20. So if Denmark has a better economic freedom score than the United States, and we think economic freedom is a good way to measure the robustness of markets and the constraint of the state, then there are some ways we could be more like Denmark. And here's those ways. I mean, one issue that I think, again, gets lost is it's easier in some ways when you have a more homogenous population to engage in this type of redistribution. With 8 million people, it's easier to do than with 330 million. I don't think it's economically the right thing to do, but it's easier. The other thing is Denmark and Sweden and these kind of economies, they have much fewer regulations. So this is where the United States is losing in economic freedom. Every year, by the way, we lose a point. In 2000, we were number 2 in the world. We're 16 now, projected to continue dropping. So that's bad. Why? The regulatory state is so cumbersome that it makes it hard for people to start businesses. In Denmark, there's a lot of redistribution. We take a lot from people, you know, when we put it in a pot and we say, get to take a year off after you have kids, free education, free daycare. There's a lot of redistribution where I think they could get better, but they don't have a lot of regulations. So it's easy to start a business. It's easy to grow a business. It's much easier than in the U.S. So I think we have to talk about these things on the margin. I wouldn't say U.S. just do everything like Denmark.
Yeah.
But there are margins in which we are much worse in terms of economic freedom because we constrain businesses and things like that. Now, what do I think Denmark could do better? Stop redistributing so much.
Yeah.
I think education would be better if it was competitive. And why do I think that? It's not ideological, it's empirical. Because when the private market can do something, it can do it better. Now, there's some things the private market can't do, but I think it could do education.
Yeah.
You know, national defense, okay, fine, it really doesn't do that well, so you need a state for some of these things. But I think we have to have the conversation, again, what's the alternative? That's the question economists ask. So we want to say, what is the alternative to Denmark? And, you know, I think that's where you have a conversation about things on the margin we could change.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
I looked up the Index of Economic Freedom while we were discussing that. And the United States and Denmark are actually ranked identically in the
latest one. Are they both 16?
The United States is 17 and Denmark is 18, but they both have an economic freedom index of 75.1. So I'm not sure that would be like an excellent argument tactic because they can just pull up evidence to show.
The point here is that if you look at their overall score and then go down and look at the five pillars on which they're graded, and that's where you see the differences. So I think that I would still stand by my point, which is that there are ways we can be more like Denmark. But I don't think that's what Sanders meant, but let's just not try to interpret what he meant. I think in real life, we could be more like them and they could be more like us on some margins. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks, guys. Thanks a lot.
All right, guys, go ahead and take about a 5-minute break, and then we'll reset for our